Great. So, yes, Brexit has become challenging. And hopefully today I'm going to talk to you about things that you can do as Jamie Mason. I'll be talking about your future because it's one of the things that you can do and you can help your children. But other than that, some of the framework chairs are taken. And yes, and for people at the back who have some bigger acreages, we also do a lot of extension events when we talk about more about tree growth. So those will be some of the events and maybe if you sign up for the newsletter, you will know more about this. So anyway, getting started. In my presentation, we will talk about general basics about citrus variety, how do you plant those, maintenance, irrigation, which is very important for hydration, and pruning. And then we talk about some of the diseases which are not more, which are more of a physiological disorder. And then Dr. Megan will be talking about diseases. So, let's start with citrus. It is from a family, a big species, a family called Rutaceae. And it is a very important crop. It's grown in many countries. As you know, we have, it's grown even in Japan. So in Japan, in South America, it's grown pretty much everywhere. And it is very popular for its fragrance, oils, and then fruit, of course. And one thing that I learned after coming here is that actually the honey from the citrus flowers is very good in taste. So a lot of the beekeepers bring their bees, even though we do not need in commercial citrus, we do not need bees as much as in other industries that we don't bring. We don't need bees as much, but because the honey just tastes so good that the beekeepers are bringing their bees. So something interesting that we learned in the past few years about citrus, that actually citrus originated from the foothills of Himalaya. So here in this picture, what you see, that is India on and then that's China. So somewhere from the foothills of Himalaya between India and China, that's where the origin of citrus was. This was a big scientific paper published last year, very reputed paper. They studied more than 300 species, figured out where the evolution happened and how it happened. This is just interesting to know, and everything has evolved in there. Now, in Florida, it was introduced in the 16th century by Spanish explorers, and now it is very well adapted for Central and South Florida. Citrus can also be grown in North Florida, but you have to find a variety because it's a tree that has been freezing at 10% of but not continuous. So this tree is a combination of a scion and a rootstock. I'm sorry if I ask basic questions, but do you know what a scion and a rootstock is? So we want different rootstocks because we want them to be adapted to the soil that we want. Now, when you are buying a tree from, say, Home Depot or Lowe's, you may not have a whole lot of options of getting a rootstock. But if you buy from a certified citrus nursery, you may have some options. And depending on where you are, you may be able to use rootstocks. For example, now we know there are some rootstocks which don't like high pH. So if your garden or yard has high pH, there are some rootstocks that you can avoid, because that is going to help you in the long term. So, the tree is a combination of a scion and a rootstock. You should always purchase it from a certified nursery. And the tree should have a label like that. We are not promoting a particular nursery, but this is what I have in my email. So, it will say the name of the nursery. It will also say the nursery registration number. So, that's some information. That's how you know that it is a certified nursery. Then it would say the variety name, so in this case it's a mixed leaf. Mixed leaf is a type of sweet orange that gets ready in December, January. It's middle of the season, it's not early or late, so that's how the name came, mixed And then you see that number there, US 802. In this case, that's the number of the foodstuff. Just something interesting, US there stands for USDA, Middle East foodstuff. If you see US, that means USDA relief. If you see US, that means US employment. And then there are some common stocks like older, which was single, which was on the meaning of a hot person. So you will see those different names, and you will know that it's a different picture. So if you buy these things, they are performing differently in your yard, and you notice they have different risks, so that could be one of the reasons. The risks are very important. And then Scion, we pay more attention because we know whether we want a lemon tree, a lime tree, a mandarin, or fruit orange to go up in the I'm not going to spend too much time on the variety. I'd rather use time to think about it for some time. But you have those slides in your handout so you can look at the picture. The sweet orange is good if you want to extract fresh juice from your tree. So sweet orange is a good option. And the other good for the juice for fresh consumption, there are white, pink, and red colored grapefruit, so really you can choose what you want. They are very popular. Mandarins are very common. They have different categories. All are different, but somehow it does get mixed up. There are quite a few varieties that are suitable for Florida. I don't have time to pick a particular variety there. It's named Sugarville. You may also see something like LB8-9 that is more of a mandarin that is stuff. The Sugarville is a newly released variety of mandarin. Its parents are Mimola, and Honeybell is one of its parents. And the reason I'm underlining Sugarbell is because it is somewhat tolerant to bloom. So it can grow under disease pressure. Of course, you have to take care of it. Everything has become more difficult to eat. But Sugarbells have been showing tolerance, so it's a good option if you can manage to get it and you want to manage it. Now, mandarins do need some pollinizers, so that's something to keep in mind, that mandarins are better for pollinization than the other mandarins. But there are options, and for example, if you have temple in your neighborhood, there isn't a good pollinizer that doesn't have a good pollinizer. So I do have them. If you do lemon, lime, lemon and lime, they are the food, the flower food is still available in but they really don't like seeds or frozen that in the soil. If you are in North Florida, it might be a challenge. This is a group of oddballs here. I can just use two examples here. So these are citrus, but they are already listed and not commercial or common use. So we got a flag because they are commercial. Citrus are a big fruit that's a dispersed taste more like turkey. It's more like turkey and you need a finger. And then the third one, finger lime. This is actually getting a lot of attention these days because so finger lime, it is interesting because it looks like a finger and then it's an acidic fruit. It tastes like lime or lemon, but it is not a lime again. And the vesicles are round vesicles, so when you cut open the fruit, actually it's really interesting. There is a lot of interest in finger lime, so in like bigger cities where there are more high-end restaurants where they're using for caviar or some of the things are drinks or things like that. So finger lime is getting attention, but it's more expensive. And we have people working on finger lime in Europe, and one of the reasons is finger lime obviously shows some sort of tolerance to it. It's not originated from Australia. It is somewhat tolerant. We are still working on it, so it's not very steady, but it is very tolerant to it. So, root stocks are important when we talk about it. And they're also important because they can impart cold habits. So if you are in North Florida, you should pay more attention to the root stock in terms of cold habits. And generally, a root stock which has charcoal with bacteria would be more cold habits. But still, when it's a common one, at least it would be a root stock. So if you are in cold areas, you should think about taking these. And then as far as the varieties are concerned, mandarins are the most cold hardy. Fruit orange is basically the most like a lot of lines of fruits. Mandarins, like Satsuma mandarin, it's a very common mandarin. It's in the New Japan, there are many other mandarins that are here in Japan, so they have very good. And one of the reasons is if you harvest, if the variety that you have gets harvested before December, it can actually escape the cold weather, then you have no chance of that. So what I do is when it gets harvested, I just need to understand the weather, just need to make sure that it's in there. Because you don't want to sleep on the tree and then not see the weather. So, yeah. Now, general information about citrus. Tree plantings, definitely what people get in the house, and they're going to be all there, they're going to be you should take out any weeds that are in that area. And then a couple of things to pay attention when you buy a tree, and that same even for our commercial growers, when you take the tree out of the pot, you should pay attention to the roots. If the roots are getting round like a spiral, then that's not a good situation because the root may become the tree can become root bound, and that's not good. So if you see some amount of spiraling of the root, it's good to do root pruning, which is basically take a tree now and you cut roots and cut to discontinue that spiral from going down. And we tell our growers that if you see bad roots like that, then you should not be pruning if they're going down. Now, planting is important, so it's important that you take out the plant, check the root ball, how it looks, and then maybe loosen it up a little bit, and then you dig a hole which is as big as your root ball or whatever it is. It's really important to cover all of your roots. The roots don't like failing and sunlight, so you have to make sure that you cover them properly. So the hole has to be good. Now, the time to plant the hole will be or early fall, that's when there is less activity happening in the plant. It's good for the tree at that time. Once you have planted a tree, you have to go back to it, but you want to give it first to the roots to get the tree started. You do not want to give it to the root fertile with the plant and start it. So it's advisable that you do not do anything for the first 2 weeks, and then you can apply a fertilizer which is a complete blend of all the nutrients. We don't talk about fertilizers a little bit more, but it is important to fertilize. Also, fertilizers in the small amounts. So if you want to put 1 ounce of fertilizer in the whole year, it's important to split it up because the nutrient has small root systems. The same cannot take up a lot of nutrients. It's important to split it in small pieces. So, as I said, the flowers are the tree, and then February to September, because that's when most of the growth is going to happen, and it will be good for the tree. Now, watering is very important, even when you have newly planted. Actually, you should water it immediately. You have to make sure not to overwater it. It should go light depth too, so that is a big problem. You have to water it, but just enough, not that way. Not to the extent that they stand and water them, but make sure that there is a plan to water from March to June because trees will need a lot of water and you cannot change this depending on the rain. Now, moving towards the caretaking of the mature trees, you have to make sure you put light liquid. You irrigate your tree, you keep the weeds away from the tree because often weeds are more suitable for the climate. And generally, the tree doesn't need a whole lot of pruning, but it also depends on the variety of the rootstock. So there is some amount of pruning that you need to do with the top of the tree. Irrigation, we did talk about it. Very important, actually. Water is, we have a retired faculty here, very renowned, and he always said that water is the number one plant. You have deficiency or not, you have, you don't have sufficient amount of water, the plant will go through some dehydration. It may not even appear to be, but for example, the fruit cells will become smaller because it will depend on water. So when the fruit is developing in the summer months and you don't have enough water, the fruit may be feeling that, you may not see it. You may see the fruit. Water tree can have a bigger size too in a small water deficiency. Also, you will see symptoms of wilting if your tree is not getting enough water. You will see these soft leaves. It kind of starts to fully extend it to become a little flat. It can go up and reduce that water loss. So, in that condition, definitely water. So, it's a good idea to water your plants twice a year, or if you have less than 50% of the nutrient, it's really good. Now, mineral irrigation, that's what I will do. My favorite topic. I need to go over some of the basics, which is just not good for applicable to citrus, but also pretty much any crop or any plant that you grow. So, there are 14 essential mineral nutrients. Which a plant needs. Now, some nutrients might be needed in more amount and some in less amount, but that doesn't make one more important than the other. Each of those 14 nutrients are equally important. With citrus, so far we have been able to only choose 30, so even though we say there are 14 essential nutrients, there's one nutrient that we have not proven yet, that is crucial, but we know. A nutrient called nutrient. And so earlier people were categorizing nutrient as a crucial. And then there was this problem in Pecan trees in Georgia that they were seeing some symptoms of the leaf and nobody could figure out what happened. After years of research, first the researcher published that it's a man research agency. And when he did more research, and then 5 years later, he figured out that he was wrong. Another paper saying that I was wrong 5 years ago, which was very interesting that he was the first person to prove that nutrient is a solution for the plant. We have not shown that in citrus, but having said that, we have nutrient in our program because we don't know. And also, within that small amount that you may not even apply to the same. So, something that I want to show you, and that's really important, is that the plant takes the nutrients from the with its root. And actually, the nutrients need to be dissolved in the water. So when you irrigate the plant and you put the fertilizer there, actually the fertilizer mixes in the water. So the nutrients that you see here, like nitrogen and carbon, actually get dissolved in the water droplet. And when the tree is picking up the water, that's when it picks up the nutrients. So if you apply a fertilizer but do not irrigate any of your tree sometimes, you may not even see the nutrients. So it's important. Salt and water and irrigation. Nutrients and irrigation go hand in hand, and it's very important to have a good irrigation. Now, there are some fertilizers that we see in the market that may be more familiar applied. They are good, but I do want to clear go on some other basics that is important to know. So, now, have you heard about mobile nutrients or mobile plant nutrients at all? So, this may be useful then. Mobile plant nutrients, as the name suggests, means nutrients that move around, that are mobile. So, forest can get into these forests, can get out of this leaf and go to that leaf. Or, surface can go out from this leaf to a tree or river. So, these are mobile nutrients. So, nitrogen, I'm sure you might have seen a nitrogen deficiency. You can always see its pale yellow color, but it is also a fully extended mature leaf. That's what you see. If you can see on the young leaves, you actually see on the older leaves. And the reason is because nitrogen is very mobile, so you move in the plant. So, as we always take care of the nitrogen, so you get the same picture of the nitrogen. So, this nitrogen actually moves to the new leaf, and that's when you see the deficiency in the older leaf. So anytime you see that you can see the older leaves, those are the nutrients that are mobile. And then you have the immobile nutrients, which are basically longer nutrients. They cannot move out. Wherever you apply, that's where it's going to stay. The reason why I say it's important to note is that if you are solely relying on foliar fertilizer, whether you are spraying your tree with a fertilizer, then the boron is the same. Wherever you spray, it doesn't go to the fruit, it doesn't go to the leaves. So it's more important as we are learning about the fertilization that you apply to the fruit because nitrogen actually moves on in the water and it goes wherever the water goes. So it's better to have a solid applied fertilizer. You can have foliar, but you cannot just rely on it. It's very important, that's something that we have been talking about to put growers as well. And with one long tenure, it should be even long tenure. Soil applied fertilizer. So if you have citrus trees, consider applying fertilizer to the soil. Again, the fertilizer needs to be applied in small doses because trees can take a very small amount of time. Otherwise, it will just leach out of the soil. So we have talked about all the things I can see. And these trees with the in small amounts for the leaf. There are some brands which are called 6-6-6, so those are good brands. But we have to really pay attention to that, what those fertilizers have. So, have you guys learned how to use the fertilizer labels in your process? Do you think that you are going to know this? That actually, based on what they are using, the main nutrient, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. But between the other nutrients too. So you really need to pay attention to what else is on that label. So in this case, this fertilizer has calcium, which is 2.5% of the nutrients. And this fertilizer also talks about that it is a polymer coating of children, which means this is one of the control units fertilizer. So control units fertilizer, like we have seen a brand margin of course, which is also controlled by the rental advantage is that you will be traveling for the whole summer and you will not be able to get there on the street. At that time, a controlled use for that is a good idea of your platform. So that even if you're not there, you're there for 6 weeks, but controlled use for that is the leases, the nutrients, and control you need to pay attention to the label to know what all is there. So in this particular case, I saw that online. They talked about 8 to 9, but then also it has an evening and an evening and an evening. And then you see about calcium, you have to see the calcium, then you have calcium, and calcium is also very important. So, moving to the nutrient deficiencies, it is important to know that it's been deficient in the doctor, including the deficiency. Potassium deficiency, it's interesting, usually you would not see it, but if your food is full of fruit, then you may see potassium deficiency. It is, you will see yellowing of the pits, and then margins become broader. So in that case, because fruit actually takes up a lot of potassium, so the fruit gets all the potassium, and then you see the potassium. If you want good crop, boron deficiency is insufficient, but you do not see much failure from the leaves, but you will start seeing the cracking of the leaves start to become thick, and that is actually also one of the symptoms for HIV. If you have always thought boron deficiency to be HIV, you are considered to be boron deficiency. Manganese, it will be on the younger leaves because it's talking about also immobile, so the leaves will have the deficiency. And actually, I do have some leaf samples that I think also have. And then copper, it's very uncommon. Usually, for the leaves, it's not a deficiency, but it's usually you will see an interesting S-shaped cliff in the throat that has enough sulfur, I'm sorry, copper, but it's not common. Now, if you over-apply fertilizer, you will see fertilizer burn in your tree. And like we have talked about that, because the nutrients are dissolved in the water, whenever the water is taken up, the nutrients are taken up. So if you have over-applied the tree, then you're not going to stop. And these nutrients are accumulated in the leaves, and you start to burn the water, so it dries the leaves, starts to be symptoms on the edges. And maybe a good idea would be to water your tree a lot, so that you can get some infection in the zone, and so you can have a patient's health. You can also see herbicide damages. They are more at the context, so if you have used the Roundup or any sort of a weed killer in the yard, you will see the few symptoms. And they will be very different from the nutrient deficiency because they look like the nutrient. They will only happen wherever contact has happened. Now, glyphosate foliar may not recover contact, but actually the leaves become very narrow, and it might be on the lower branches. Now, talking about pruning, pruning is important because it maintains your skin and it maintains your shape and size that you want to achieve. Grooming is actually one of the oldest hot pulsing techniques that people have used. Now, light grooming would be a good idea to use for your skin because it's very important. The strategy will change is that you open the pattern because you do not use them like the second type of cut is heading bent. So you have your tree and you have to cut the branches or the top part without thinking. So it's non-selective, and that's what this is. This is a non-selective cutting of the edges or the sides. This is what we're doing here. We are heading back. So as a result, you see more growth. So you have that, and then just a tree that's had a tree. Because it also things have got here. So because of some of the hormone balance, you see more growth happening. So that's it. So just a tree that can have this more incredible or they used to have before it can be a dimension of wall or now in your front yard or in your backyard, where you will have fewer trees. Now, commercial growth is really difficult to have. Do hand cutting or trimming for thousands of trees. But if you have few trees in your backyard and you have time, then you will be trimming for them to be more beneficial for the tree. So that's what the tree really likes. Very nice conditions. Pruning is a considering for it because the trees do grow a lot. They will just become tall and so you need to prune them. In first 3 years, it's really not needed. Also, if you start your root stock to grow out, then you need to think about it. Because root stock generally are more vigorous because they have no burden of pruning to grow. If you let it grow, so now, quickly moving to harvesting, you need to know when to harvest your fruit. are the three conditions for us to know, but it may not be from the start. So we really need to know what's in the design of these things, and we need to know what the two shapes are, so we have to know what it is from each other. Also, we want to make sure that we small food dropping, do not be alarmed about it, that a way of change to balance the crop, that is going to be handy. So don't worry about that. But if long lending is a tree that flows through the harvest, there is some something that is happening. And there is nothing that is going on. The tree starts dropping through the tree that is going to start. If you have learned, if you have a good education program, it's helping to start. Some rain is falling, but the food is still up for 3 days, and you can eat it. So if you see some rain, it's kind of just some sun. If you want it on the structure that you want it to be, it's just a little bit. Slippings, it is seen when you have potassium deficit condition, because the food can make a lot of potassium for the food equipment. Also, if you get a lot of rainfall, then you will see food splitting. Basically, what happens is you have the rainfall, the water starts getting accumulated, and the food cannot. After rainfall, you will see that there has been a lot of rainfall,